The idea of this talk is just to connect dots, okay? So it's not to explain really anything new, but just that you have an overall view of different architectures that we are going to explain. So I'm going to refer to the previous architectures that Santi and Lisa have introduced, and later I will give an overview of some future architectures that will be introduced to you. So in general, to prepare this talk, I use this kind of cheat sheet, which is very, very useful. It's like an overview of different architectures for networks, so I'm going to always refer to these diagrams for the talk. So as Sandy has explained, is the most basic architecture we can think about. That's a perceptron. You just have one neuron, and you want to predict value y based on, to say, the simplest possible option is just based on x, y, and like x1 and x2. And this is the diagram that corresponds to the perception. If you have two perceptrons and then you add a softmax layer, you can build a classifier with that. And you can just predict, like, given an input, which is the class that you want to predict, x, y, or x2. And also predict a probability for your predicted class. You can make things much more complicated. Here there are like three classes, just adding perceptrons. And mathematically, you can decompose this in this matrix form or this algebraic form. So what happens when you make things a bit more complicated? You start adding layers, then you have the multi-layer perceptron. Again, that's something that Santi already explained. Okay, I'm just connecting the dots. Here you have like three layers. And if you start adding more and more layers, then that's when deep learning arrives. So you go deeper and deeper. And that's also more parameters. This means that training, estimating these parameters will require more data, will require more time, more computation. So there's always like a trade-off between how many layers, how much data you have, and what's the accuracy you want to expect. And that's always a trade-off that you must have in mind. Because when you will start with the project, you say, oh yeah, I'm going to put like 1,000 layers there. But then you notice that you cannot manage that. Whether you don't have enough data, you don't have enough memory, or you will need to find the right balance for that. A network which we have not talked about it yet, that's they are called recurrent neural networks. In the previous ones, what we are doing is we just have input data and we forward pass the data to predict the labels, and during the training you do the back propagation to kind of adjusting the weights of your neurons. Yeah, that was the previous ones. What's new with recurrent? The recurrent neural networks, there's this kind of a family, let's say. In this case, the hidden layers and the output not only depend from the input, but also from the previous states of that layers. So if I say previous, it means that there's somehow a temporal sequence. Okay, now you must think about time steps, that the data, the input data is arriving in at different time steps. Yeah, and then there's some sort of memory. The network knows the previous state, and based on where he was and on the new input, we're going to propagate through network. Yeah, that's the general idea on recurrent neural networks. When you look at these networks, there's something tricky that you must always be careful, is that so far we have presented the networks in a frontal view like this. Yeah, so input, output, and you go up. But when you introduce time, now you want to kind of represent that there's a temporal sequence. There are many representations of these networks that there's a rotation of 90 degrees. So you go from a frontal view to a side view. Yeah. And when you see these architectures, always sometimes a bit tricky to remember that sometimes you see it frontal, sometimes you see it from a side view. Yeah, just remember, especially when tomorrow Santi starts explaining recurrent, which view are you looking at? So again, as this is just a pointer lecture, more details tomorrow Santi will give you about recurrent neural networks. And not only we'll talk about this, let's say, basic architecture that I just introduced, where there's a temporal feedback, this memory in the network, but there are some other more complex architectures with something called gates the most popular ones, they're called LSTM or GRUS. Maybe you've heard about them. That's that normally when you implement in speech and language, you use one of these models. And tomorrow you will see how exactly it works. Yeah, but in both cases there's a temporal recurrence. That's my message that I want you to have. If you so actually last week we discovered that there's a nice set of videos, very didactic, educational. I have embedded all of them in my presentation. So if you want to learn more in very nice, let's say, colors and animations, you can look at these videos. This one is the one for recurrent. I think I'll send you an email already advising you to take a look at them. Then another family of architectures, that's what Elisa has explained. These are the convolutional neural networks. Elisa already explained that they are widely used in computer vision, as well used in speech and language. And here the idea is that you are not going to have everything connected, but your weights will focus in one part of the input signal. And again, you have many layers, and you have some other typically some other layers like the relu and the pooling that makes the architecture a bit more complex. This architecture, I can't remember if Elisa put it in her slides. Okay, no. So this architecture is the most famous one in computer vision. That's called AlexNet, and that was this architecture. It meant a breakthrough. Like it outperformed all handcrafted techniques that had been designed until 2012 in a task called ImageNet Challenge. In that task, there are a large amount of images, and you must predict the objects that appear in the image. Yeah, and when these people from the University of Toronto just remember these names, okay? Especially George Frickinson and Lia Sutskever, and that's Alex Krizevsky. That's why this network is called AlexNet. Remember these names because they will just keep appearing in the next slides a lot. So they made a very interesting work. It has like 1,000 citations, and everybody is referring to this work when in computer vision when dealing with deep learning. So Elisa already explained convolutional neural networks, so I will not go any further, but this will be like the equivalent figure with the same notation that I'm using in these slides. Lately also, sorry, here you have again a nice video if you want to learn more. And also in computer vision, we have seen, or it has become very popular, the issue of using also deconvolutional networks. This means that if you remember when Elisa explained that there are different layers used typically in convolutional neural networks, one of them are called pooling. And when you do the pooling, basically what you're doing is you're taking some samples, some features, and you reduce the dimension. So you're kind of reducing dimensionality. And in some problems, like images, where in many cases you have an input image that has whatever size, whatever pixels width and height, in many cases you want to have an output that will have the same size. Like, for example, a problem called semantic segmentation, which means given each pixel, just say if the class that represents that pixel, if that's a person, if that's a car, if that's the road, that's the sky. Yeah, so you need the input data, the dimension of the input data must match the dimension of the output data. And as convolutional neural networks, they when you introduce these pooling layers, you lose dimensionality. If you want the output to have the same dimension, you need to do something to get back. And deconvolutional layers, which also can be trained, it's a way to solve this problem. There are others, but that's one of them. Then, another architecture that I think that Santi maybe, or Elisa at least, will talk about tomorrow a little bit, are autoencoders. And so I think that so far we've talked about classification and regression. But these neural networks can be used for other purposes, and actually there's a lot of interest in these other purposes, which can be, use the data without labels. So you just have lots of data. You don't know what's in that data. You don't know if there are I'm thinking about speech examples like male speakers or female speakers or happy speakers, whatever. You don't know that, you just have speech. But and you want to use that for something. So one thing you can do is you have your input data, and you input in this network. You have some neurons. Here there's only one layer. And here at the output, what you want is to reproduce the same data you had at the input. Yeah, and then you train the network so that here at the output, you have the same as in the input. That's the idea of the autoencoder. Yeah, so you don't need any labels at all. And that's normally referred to one type of unsupervised learning, because you don't need labels. So I guess that some of you should, if you're not familiar with machine learning, at least you think like, what, why would I want to do something that stupid as predicting the same data that as I have at input, because I already have it. Yeah, so it's interesting if you have some speech and you want to know what word is that person saying, but if you want have speech and you want to predict the same speech, that at least you should think like, what's the use of that? Yeah? Does it make sense? Great. So there are some reasons why it can be interesting. One of them is that in these intermediate layers, what you could do is you reduce the dimension. So you say, oh, I have this input vector. It has this large dimension. And I train a network where the intermediate layers will have a smaller dimension. That means then you if you can do that, it means that the information that it's going forward and backward, so you have the input signal and the output, so it goes through and backward, it's condensed. It can be condensed if you take just this low-dimensional layer, the features there. And you can represent it with that. And that has some applications. These are the idea of the autoencoders. Here you have some video. And there's one of the applications, it's a bit more complex, but I think you like the example, are called variational autoencoders. So imagine that that this latent vector, let's say this hidden layer that you learn here in the middle, which is has a reduced dimension. So reduced dimension is already useful, for example, if you want to, let's say, compress your data. Yeah, just for that, you keep it in disk, and that's less storage, for example, for coding. That's already one application. But let's think about what else can we do there. So if you make, what you could do, what people have done is say, okay, now I'm going to introduce some conditions on this vector that I'm training, this hidden layer. And for example, I'm going to introduce that I want these vectors to follow a unique Gaussian distribution. Yeah. If you do that, then you are training a variational autoencoder. That's what you say. And if you do that, and that, then it becomes the nice part, is that later, so you train a network with your 1,000 images or 1 million images of cats, yeah? They all go through on that, you learn on the weights, and then later, what you could do is you just take the second part of the network, and here, you know that here, this network has been trained that in such a way that if you generate samples from a unique Gaussian distribution, at the output, you are going to generate something which is similar to cats. You're kind of modeling the distribution of cat images. And with that, you can create new samples. You can create new cats. That's the idea. This is called generative models, and Santi will talk much more on this tomorrow. These are some examples of faces that have been created artificially with a variational autoencoder. Yeah? Then, I don't know. Then you can ask me, like, what's the application of generating new samples? But Santi will address this issue in his talk. Okay, so that's the figure that I wanted to explain that summarizes the variational autoencoders. Then there are other types of autoencoders that I will also mention, which are very, very popular. This one is even a bit simpler because it only has two layers, the input layer and the hidden layer, and it just goes, I think it goes so forward and backward for training. You just iterate many, 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 many times. And in the end, again, if you have here a dimension which is, for example, less more than this one, it's not this example, but just imagine that you have example of that, you could, for example, just learn features which are of reduced dimension. It's just an autoencoder. And what you could do with this concept of I have two layers and I forward and backward train, you could do that like many times, right? You could put like a restricted, sorry, I didn't, maybe I didn't mention the name. These are called restricted Boltzmann machines. So if you just could put just one after the other, and then what you build is something called deep belief networks. Yeah, and again, I want you to take a look again of this guy here, Geoffrey Hinton. Again, he's one of the most popular authors in this field of deep learning. And they one of the contributions of the applications of these networks is, okay, so you have lots of data, remember, that's unsupervised learning. You train your network like by pairs of layers. And what you could do is at the end, so first you have a lot of data. which is not labeled. You train your network, and then you have some labels, not many, and with that, with those some labels and everything you had trained previously, now you train to really predict the labels for those small amount of data. And by doing that, you are benefiting from all this previous work that you have done here with no need of labeling. Your network has already become familiar with your data, with the distribution of your data. And at the end, when you say, okay, now I want to solve the classification problem, for example, you just need a few samples, let's say. Yeah. So one of the problems of supervised learning is that if you want to train supervisely, you need many samples. I mean, if you want to train neural networks, you need many samples. If you want to do supervised learning, you need many labels. Generating labels means that a human person typically looks at your data or listens to that audio and writes what people were saying, and that's very costly. Okay, you require a human, which is super expensive. Yeah, and of course, if you can make things easier, if you can work with few labels, that's going to help you a lot. I'm pretty sure you're going to have these kind of problems when you work on your project. So that's just the introduction. Elisa will tell you tomorrow, first lecture in the morning, more about these two type of architectures. And you have a video and another video. And here you have Geoffrey Hinton. That's the guy that I wanted to mention. So he's in Toronto, I think that's so. And he's one of the chief engineers at Google nowadays, working on all this machine learning thing. And also, before I mention the other guy, Ruslan Salakidinov. Okay, I'm sorry for the pronunciation. He's the director of artificial intelligence at Apple. Okay, and this guy here is Andre Min. He's working at a company called Google DeepMind. Maybe you've heard about it. They did this thing of AlphaGo. Artificial intelligence. Maybe you've heard about Uriol Vinyals, one of the most important researchers we have in our country, who is the one of the leaders of this Google DeepMind. Okay, so they are these guys. They invented all these tools. Or they made it train quickly, and now they are leading the most important tech companies worldwide on artificial intelligence. Yeah, so you're in the good track. So maybe in a few years you will be also leading some nice lab. Okay, so this is the full chart. I didn't go through all of it, but you can click here and look more on this. And as I have another lecture tomorrow, I guess we're going to look at some more of these architectures. So that's all for my talk. And maybe you have questions.